at this church in Terrell, Texas. We're so glad you're here. We're about to get started in just a minute. Just want you to know that you're here. You're welcome. We have a whole community that's to come. We have all the community that's been in service. I want to invite you to partake by having some juice and bread and all that you can be part of that journey. God bless you. Appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
service. My name's Pastor Pete. If you don't know me, good to meet you. I'm glad you're part of this. We're here together. Can everybody hear me okay? You sure it's loud enough there? Okay, good. Good job. So I want to share with you something in your bulletin. That is, we've got a index card. Everybody hold their index card up so you can see what you have. Okay, good. Everybody got one. That's good. So you people at home, you don't have an index card, you can get an index card and just do something. It's got something written on there I want you to pay attention to. It says, I give thanks for the life and impact of, and I gave some space, but I got a couple of names over there. This is a morning I want you to sort of reflect on people who have poured in to you. In other words, people who have been what we call salt and light in your life. And I just want you to put two names down. Now, that'd be the two most people who poured the most into you, but just whatever the Spirit leads you to, put a couple of names down on this card. We're going to deposit these cards in this basket during Holy Communion today. So the basket is down here. So we'd love to have your thoughts on just two names, people who have impacted your life, that you give thanks for. So we'll do that in a little bit. So I want to share with you that we had a wonderful kickoff last Sunday with my professor from Perkins, who spoke here and he gave the message that we had here for our Testimony HQ kickoff. And so we're involved in this grant that we have to learn really how to share more about Jesus in our lives and how we can talk to people, even one-on-one, maybe especially one-on-one with friends. And so I was really impressed with the good group we had that stayed for the lunch last Sunday, as well as developing and understanding and doing some fun exercises, even some role play, of how we talk about our faith to people. And one of the things we did was we developed a short definition, just as our group, of what testimony is. Now, Priscilla tells me that in a lot of churches, it took hours to be able to figure out how they could agree on a definition. This group came to a definition pretty quickly. I've got it on this giant post-it note still. I'm not sure. It's kind of hard to read, but let me just go over this with you real quickly and see if maybe we can read this kind of together. It says, testimony is sharing by talking to people about your faith in God through your personal journey. That's what testimony is. This was developed by you guys with the definition. Testimony is sharing by talking to people about your faith in God through your personal journey. You know, an easier way or a shorter way to say that is that a good story is a God story. And you have the ability to share how God is working in your life, not just back when you were 13 years old or back when you were in a difficult time in college or other time in your life, but how God is working through your life this very week. A good story is a God story. So, enjoy doing that. We had a great time with the choir yesterday. A lot of the choir went to Kavanaugh United Methodist Church in Greenville. And we had a choir workshop, and I got to film a video with them. That was very special. So, I just want you to know also today, like I said, it's Holy Communion Sunday, and we have a couple things going on. One is we have, for Holy Communion, we have some special little chalices, you might say. Pretty cool. This is new and improved version after COVID, you know. But now we've got easier to open. It's a really good thing. We're going to have regular bread, folks, here. But at home, if you have a loved one at home that you'd like to bring Holy Communion to, these are extra. You take one of these home. And you say, this has been consecrated. We've already had our worship experience. You can take some of these home. We have more that you can take home to your loved ones. It's Holy Communion with the bread at the bottom and the juice here. So that's part. We also have a gluten-free option for those that are gluten-free. So we've got some things. We want to be very inclusive for Holy Communion. We also want to be able to realize that we can take it beyond these walls, people beyond this church. We may need to receive the grace of Jesus Christ through the bread and through the juice that we have for Holy Communion. So we also collect a special rail offering every time we have Holy Communion, and that just money goes basically in the offering plates here. And what that's going to be for is money for UMCOR. UMCOR is the United Methodist Committee on Relief, which is right there in Baldwin, Louisiana, and it's a place that we've been with our youth and some adults before. It's a depot for United Methodist Committee on Relief. It's outside of Louisiana. It's in southern Louisiana. helps out with hurricane relief, with tornadoes, any kind of natural disasters we can help with. And we're probably going back, right? Yeah, we're working on that as a possibility.
Yeah,
going back.
I sent you some dates.
Yeah, we're looking going back, maybe this summer. But the fact is, any offering we put in here will go toward Encore, which helps us be in mission for people when they're in maybe one of the worst days of their lives. So now I'd like to ask my wife, Daria, to come up for just a few brief announcements.
As Pete mentioned, yesterday some of the members of the choir went to Greenville to have a workshop with Dr. and Professor Randy Hooper at Kavanaugh United Methodist Church. And some of y'all may remember that Dr. Hooper used to be here as the choir director. And so we had a great time yesterday doing that, and we learned a lot. And we also after we had the workshop, we had a little performance, and the Commerce, the Texas A&M Commerce Chamber Choir, they did a little performance also for us, and that was really good. And then we had lunch right before that. We had chicken and spaghetti, and that was a lot of fun. So we had a good time. And at 3 p.m. today, there's going to be the committee members and leaders of the church are invited to attend the East District Lady Training, and that's going to be at First United Methodist Church of Sulphur Springs. Everybody's welcome to attend that. Pastor Pete's going to be driving the church van, and he's going to leave the parking lot around 1:30 p.m. And all women of the church are invited to come to dinner. That's going to be tomorrow night, Monday, February 6th. As the Methodist women are going to be gathering at 5:30 p.m. in Fellowship Hall. And we're going to be hearing from our local historian, Jim McCord, and he leads the Terrell Heritage Museum. And over there at the Carnegie Library building. And when Pete and I first moved here, that's one of the first places that we went to. We just wanted to see what that was like on the inside, and we went and talked to him, to record, and it was really fascinating, and all the things in there were very interesting, so I'm looking forward to hearing him speak tomorrow night. So we hope the women of the church and friends, if you have friends, they're invited to come too. So we're very glad that you're here today, and we'd like you to register your attendance online. You can share questions you have and any prayer concerns that you might have. We'd like you to just go to fumcterrell.org and scroll down on the left-hand side. And we want to thank you for your financial support for the ministries of this church. There are three ways you can give to the church. You can place your gifts in the wooden boxes. There's one at the back of the church and one at the side. Or you can drop off or mail your checks to 503 West College Street, Terrell, Texas, 75160. Or you can go online to fumcterrell.org and just click on the big red donate button. Also in the bulletin, there's a QR code that you can scan, and it will take you to the page for giving. And then you just type in the amount that you'd like to give and the name of our church, FUMC Terrell, and that will take care of that. And then also we have, over here on my left, we have an offering plate for Ukraine, if you'd like to give to that. The people of Ukraine would greatly appreciate that. Times that they're going through right now. Now let us turn our hearts to God with this reading from Psalm 112, 1 through 9a. Praise the Lord. Blessed are those who fear the Lord, who find great delight in his commands. Their children will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. Even in darkness, light dawns for the upright, for those who are gracious and compassionate and righteous. Good will come to those who are generous and lend freely, who conduct their affairs with justice. Surely the righteous will never be shaken. They will be remembered forever. They will have no fear of bad news. Their hearts are steadfast, trusting in the Lord. Their hearts are secure. They will have no fear. In the end, they will look in triumph on their foes. They have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever.
I invite you all to stand and join our next hymn, number 159, Lift High the Cross.
You may be seated. Let's go to your bulletin and our prayer of confession. As we go before God now, may we all join in the part that's in bold faith. It's on the screens there, together. Almighty God, as the church,
you require your redeeming work in history.
Yet we know that often we seek our own success and salvation, and we call upon Christ in commitment to the vision of wholeness in the world and its peoples. Help us to speak and act our parts in the great drama of our love, and in the free gospel of Jesus Christ.
In whose name we pray.
Amen. Hear the good news. God has forgiven each one of us and calls us to take our parts in the drama of redeeming love.
Praise God,
who accepts us and uses our very human lives in the unfolding story of salvation and new life. Let us confess together that we have not always lived as those forgiven, set free, and united in Christ, O God, source of life and grace. We are aware that we are at times prisoners of fear and habit. Through the healing touch of Christ, set us free to live and to love, that we may be the people you have created us to be. Amen.
Our next hymn this morning is going to be 408, The Gift of Love. Please stand.
Crucified the Lord of glory. However, as it is written, What no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived. The things God has prepared for those who love him. These are the things God has revealed to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except their own spirit within them? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What we have received is not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may understand what God has freely given us. This is what we speak, not in words taught us by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit, explaining spiritual realities with Spirit-taught words. The person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness and cannot understand them because they are discerned only through the Spirit. The person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things, but such a person is not subject to merely human judgments. For who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
In the beginning, darkness covered the earth. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. The true light, which gives light to everyone, came into the world. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. It is a light for the lost, the searching and the seeking. A light for the darkest valley. A light to drive out fear, even in the shadow of death. When we believe in the light, we become children of the light. It shines in us, through us. If we walk in the light, if we let it shine before others, we become a city on a hill. The light of the world. When we let his word light our path, others will follow. We become a beacon of hope to a world in darkness. Our lives reflect the glory of his resurrection. He makes us a light for the nations, so his salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Let there be light. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light.
Hello, good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
So, today we're going to do something a little different. I'm going to show y'all a recording of one of the pieces we sang yesterday at this convention. But before we do that, I wanted to talk a little bit about yesterday. It was so much fun to come together as a community of singers through Christ and just create music together. The heart that we felt in that ensemble was so much fun, and it really goes to show what a can-do attitude, the right mindset, and a couple hours of rehearsal can do. But I wanted to bring one of the pieces that we did yesterday was this piece called Be Still by Mary McDonald. If you go back to the recording, it's the second piece we sang yesterday, but I wanted to read from you the text from that, because I thought it was very impactful, and it's based off of Psalm 46, verse 10. It says, "Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am with you. Be still and know that I will comfort you when you come to me in your hour of need. Be still and know that I am God, that I am here for you, and I will wipe your tears. You will be renewed." Anyways, yesterday was great and fantastic. If you want to learn more, know more, come talk to me, come talk to people that came. This piece you're about to hear
is an old English choral anthem with organ and choir, and it's big and jaunty. It's called With the Voice of Singing by Martin Shaw. I hope you all enjoy it.
Right after the Beatitudes. When you're familiar with the Beatitudes,
aren't you you know, where God's giving blessings. Jesus is giving blessings to people. He's saying things like, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall see God. Blessed are you when people persecute you and revile you, for thus they did to the prophets that came before you. Rejoice and be glad. So right after these blessings on people that you normally wouldn't think are blessed because they are poor in spirit, or they are meek, or they are hungering and thirsting for righteousness, or they're being persecuted. Right after that, as Jesus is gathering these people on the hillside, what's called Sermon Mount, and you can just imagine in your eyes seeing Christ on that mountainside. I see it as rocky, but I see it also as some grass up there. I don't know what you see. I see it as a beautiful day. That Jesus is looking out on those folks on the side of the mountain who's giving the Sermon on the Mount. He's looking out on them. He's looking out on them with compassion. He's looking out at them with a sense of, I see your hurt. I see what you're going through. And you know, I can see myself there. In fact, it's my great joy to be there a year from now. In May of next year, I hope to take a group from Terrell to the Holy Land. I hope we can take 30, 40, maybe more to go to the Holy Land and walk where Jesus walked. Experience Christ's presence in those places where Christ was, in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the Sea of Galilee, the Dead Sea, to see the amazing architectural things that were done way before even the time of Jesus, and just to experience the Holy Land. I hope to take you with me if you would like to go. It'll be probably like May 14th we're looking at next year to actually go. We'll get you more details later. But back to this mountainside, back to being at this place, of being there with Christ. And Christ is looking at these people. He's looking at these people and he's having compassion upon them. And right after that, he turns to them. He says this, two declarative statements, two you are statements. The statements are one, you are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. The second one is, you are the light of the world. Notice he's not saying, gee, y'all look like some nice folks. Maybe you can try out for the team and be the salt of the earth or be the light of the world. No. He's saying right now, in this moment, it's not a future thing, it's a present thing. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Let that soak in. But you already are. The redeeming blood of Jesus Christ, right now, by the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ, and your life, you may say, that's not me. How can I be the salt of the earth? How can I be the light of the world? But because you have Christ in you, you already are those things. It's a present tense thing, not some fine morning, I'll fly away and I'll be there. No, right now, you are the salt of the earth. Right now, you are the light of the world because of Christ in you. So think about the salt of the earth. You know, we know salt as something that's added seasoning. It makes things taste better. It makes my cholesterol go up. All these things are very good, but still, salt gives us something. Salt gives us some flavor. It's a really good thing. It's a flavor. But we don't see it because that the other way, because there's a thing that a few generations back, before we had hot point refrigerators or anything else like that, that we had preservative function of salt. There was salt was something you would do to salt your meat to keep it fresh. So just a few generations ago, salt was still being widely used as a way to preserve, to give life, to make something happen. So Jesus is saying, don't lose your saltiness. Because the world needs you, and Christ needs you. you're not going to, if you lose yourself in this, it's like throwing you out on the ground and trampling underfoot. There's really, you've lost something, but you already are the salt of the earth. You're already there. You are the salt. And God is calling you to live into that, but not lose your saltiness. Not let it go to cynicism. Not let it go to hypocrisy. But to live into the obedience of Jesus Christ in your life and keep your saltiness. And then the other one he says is, you are the light of the world. He says that. He says a city on a hill, you know, used to stand out like that. You wouldn't take a light and hide it under a bowl or hide it under a bushel, because in doing that, it's not doing any good. You know, I love seeing Rick Griffith here. He's a scout from back when I was a scout. He's Scout Leader, but I was a scout, as a matter of fact. And other scouts that are here, we're kind of in the beginning. This time of February is the anniversary of the Boy Scouts. I know if I took a show of hands, I'd see there are a lot of scouts in this room right now. A lot of you who have been scouts. I can see it's like, if you've been a Girl Scout, Boy Scout, leader, adult, just raise your hand. I just want to see. We've got several. Look at this. Look at this. Let's show them. Can you show them with the camera? Rob, show them what's going on. We've got a ton of people. Keep your hands up so we can see some in the back here, over here. People have been scouts. Wow. Lots of people have been Girl Scouts or Boy Scouts, adult scout leaders, or something like that. So you've been a number of people. Wow, that's great. It's good to see that. So one of the things about scouting is that we know that you go down some trails at night sometimes, coming back from a campfire. And you go down some trails and we need some light. You need some light to be shining, to be able to see where you're going. It's so important. James Huffman was a longtime scoutmaster. In fact, I talked to him this morning. He and Ann are down in Dripping Springs, and they lost all their power there. But James and Ann are okay. They got a wood-burning fire, and they got candles. And it's like the candles they're using, they're coming back today, thankfully, but they're down there, and they have light. Because they have those candles, and they have the wood-burning fireplace. They have something to give light. And Jesus, they talk about Jesus in John chapter 1, and it mentions that he came into he was the light of the world. He came into, and in him there is no darkness at all. He's the light of the world. Christ entering the room penetrates the darkness. And you, with the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ, when you go into a room, when you go into a place, you represent Jesus Christ. And you're going forward with that. So, once you look at the card, there was a card in your bulletin, you might see. And it talks about, I give thanks for the life and impact of somebody. Have you had a chance to write down a couple of names on that yet this morning? Let's try to write down two names of people past or present who have had an impact on your life. In other words, people who have been salt and light in your life. And I want you to put two names down. You could probably write 100 names down. Just put two names down. Just two that come to your mind. And I want you to take them, and when we get up here, I want you to place these names in this basket here, way of Holy Communion. And next Sunday, I'm going to read out those names of the people who have been salt and light. Now, maybe nobody else in the whole sanctuary knows who they are, but you know who they are. So come back next Sunday and hear all those names read aloud, or watch us online to know this. I want you to put out two names of people with whom you give thanks for the life and impact that they had on your life. You know, yesterday going to Greenville and being part of the choir that was there and seeing the other choirs that came together, I was just watching and getting to experience their voices being raised. And it reminded me of a quote from a Christian author and pastor, Peter Cesaro. And he talked about that each person, we start to just see them through the eyes of Christ. The eyes of Christ. How important it is. We should look at each person. He used these two words. He said, each person is unrepeatable and precious. There's two words. Each person out there is unrepeatable. There's only one of you. There's only one. And precious. Christ, we can look at those other people with those eyes of God and see that they are unrepeatable. impression. Both of those choirs that were there, the voices that were being raised, and I could see unrepeatable and precious that were there. And you know, Paul writes his letter to the Corinthians, his first letter to the Corinthians. As Paul's writing this letter to the Corinthians, he's in chapter 2, and he's going to say some stuff. He's going to say some hard things later on, but right now he's just trying to establish who he is and who they are. It's one of the most humble letters you can read. Because in this, he's pointing out that he is not superior or inferior to them. He's pointing out that when he came to them, all he knew was Christ and Christ crucified. That's all he knew, was Christ and Christ crucified. Now, he knew a whole lot more. This was a studied scholar of the Old Testament. He'd been taught by the famous professor Gamaliel. He'd done all kinds of things, but what he said, what's important right now is that what I knew was Christ and Christ crucified. He said he actually trembled. He actually trembled being able to speak before people because it's just understanding the majesty of it all. Understanding Christ, God, in our midst is connecting with us. So we're not superior or inferior to someone else. We are all children of God. And in these moments, Paul is writing to the church in Corinth and saying, you know, I realize that what's most important is Christ and Christ crucified in my life. It changes everything. It changes his complete attitude to who he is, to what he is to be about. You know, he didn't use the words, but if he had out of Matthew, Jesus' words, he would have said, I'm about being salt, and I'm about being light to the world. That may be our calling, to be salt and light to the world. Not a future thing, but a present thing. How we can be light, how we can be salt right now. So Scout Sunday, or the month of Scout Sunday, you might say the anniversary of Scouts, and I remind you, I can preach a lot all day long, Rick probably here too, about scouting stories. Yeah. There's lots of things that I see God's impact on us in our scouting years growing up, and also as an adult later on. But I was preparing for this message, and I was reflecting on some things, and I was remembering back to about seventh grade. I was real active in a troop in East Dallas called Troop 709. It was sponsored by Ridgewood Park United Methodist Church. And I was, by seventh grade, I was like a patrol leader. I'd been elected patrol leader of the Panther Patrol. I remember that. We had a special ditch. It said Panthers on it. It was pretty cool to be part of that. We were always trying to be very competitive with other patrols in our troop. And also we competed with other troops in the community, especially like the Camperoos. Well, right across Lover's Lane from us was another church. It was in this St. Paul Church of Christ. I think it was United Church of Christ, what it was. And they were there. All we kids knew, not about the denominations, all we knew was that we were in the red brick church and they were the white brick church. And so we were at the red brick church with Church 709, they're in the white brick church. We had a cool scout hut. We had a scout hut in the back. And we had an old building that down at Love Field that they moved out to our place. And boy, it was great. It was a neat place to have our scout program. And so every year in the springtime, right around this time, you start trying to have a little recruiting of the new kids that are coming out of fifth grade, getting ready to go into Boy Scouts. They're like Cub Scouts, they're Weebelos, we call them, and they're ready to go into one. So it got kind of competitive between the red brick church and the white brick church. You know, we're the red brick church, and we were trying to put on a good show. So we had these scouts come to business, these Cub Scouts, these younger guys. So we were told, okay, put your best foot forward. You know, try to really make a good impression on these guys. They're coming out to see you, and you want them to come join your troop later on, so you want to be good to them. And so they sat on a special bench they had. It was called the Owl Patrol. That wasn't really a real patrol. It was just called the Owl Patrol because owls do what? They watch. They're watching. So we said, these boys, these are fifth graders, younger kids, they're sitting over on the Owl Patrol. They're watching us to see who we're going to be, how we're going to live out our lives. And so I was a patrol leader of the Panthers, and I was going to talk to those younger guys and try to talk to them about coming to join our troop and I'd love to have them in my patrol and try to recruit them and everything like that, try to make a good impression. Well, one night, we had a fifth grade boy, kind of a little guy, named Richard. And Richard comes, and he comes and he sits over on the out patrol bench, and we talked to him, encouraged him.
did some things with them and taught them some scouting skills, try to encourage him, and then come back and everything. Well, that all worked fine for that night, but the next day at lunch, we're on the school playground. And I was a seventh grader, and that was the oldest age of kids in the school. And, you know, after lunch, we're all kind of just running around, you know, just playing tag or whatever on the playground. And, you know, the bigger kids, you know, we kind of do what the bigger kids do. We tackle the little kids, you know. And maybe we were a little rough at times, that sort of thing. And I think that was the day that I reached my full quota of tackling fifth graders, I guess it was, you know. And you know, maybe I was a little rough at times. I was a little rough at times. Maybe I was not exactly the image I should be. All of a sudden, Richard gets up, little guy, comes up to me with his finger in my face. He says, "And you're supposed to be an example of Scout from Troop 709. He walks away mad. He's like, mad as all get out. That stuck with me to this day, to realize that here I was acting one way in the Scout meetings. And then the next day on the playground, I was playing rough. And this fifth grader pointed out to me my hypocrisy. I was not being obedient to the Scout oath or the Scout law, but really the law of God in my life. A fifth grader. And it stuck with me. How are you doing at being the salt of the earth? Not just in these walls, but beyond these walls. How are you doing at being the light of the world? Not just in these walls, but beyond these walls." Well, the rest of the story, Richard actually did join our troop. And he became part of our troop and was later in my patrol. I know he was always watching me to kind of see what's going on. We kept doing campouts together and all kinds of things. And then when I was much older, like about 17 or so, we took a big trip to the Philmont Scout Ranch in northern New Mexico. It's a backpacking trip, 10 days, like 70 miles, uphills all the time, you know, just really tough, carrying 50 pounds a backpack around. And I'd been a couple years before, and I'd gotten bigger as far as my strength, and I was pretty good size, and I could handle those trails. And I would just lead that group of 16 scouts, and just going up the hills and swearing. And little guys, the younger ones, were hollering, "Pete, you're going too fast. We can't keep up. We gotta slow down." I'd listen to them for about 30 seconds. That's about it. I'd take off. So I would just be going fast. But one time we were in a break on the trail, and we took our backpacks off, and I went to do something, and I came back. We got power stuff there. Put my backpack on. And it was just heavy. Maybe I was tired. Just trying to keep going. We went on two or three more miles. And we got to camp. We get to camp, I start unpacking. There's these two giant boulders in my backpack. I look over at Richard. He's 15 by now. I look over at Bruce, his friend. Look at these sly smiles on their faces. Maybe they succeeded in trying to slow me down just a little bit. And Richard went on to play football. He went on to become really active in bodybuilding and physical fitness. And, you know, after he graduated from college, Richard opened up his own gym, started a gym, ran it for several years, a very successful gym that he had. And later on, he got married, and they had a child, and the child was scouting, and Richard became their scout master. And I've got a picture here of Richard at Philmont just last year. We can show that picture of John. Here it is. Take a look. Richard is the guy on the left. I would not want to be tackling him today. He's become very strong. And then that's his son next to him up the mountains. So I wrote down my part, one of the names I have. Is Richard Bondichek. Because he was salt and light. He still is in my world. So then my brother, Andrew McNabb, was poured into me in so many ways. So who do you have? Who do you have on your card? People who are salt and light who have been salt and light in the world. You see, I believe Jesus is calling you not to get in the game. He's calling you to remember that you already are in the game. He's calling you to be salt. He's calling you to be light because he needs you. And I need you as well. It's time now for Holy Communion. You turn to page 12 in your hymnal. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Together, merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have failed to be an obedient church.
We have not done any wrong.
We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not honored or cried the need.
Forgive us this prayer. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It's right for the good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy God,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves with praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. We proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here. And on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ. We may be for the world. The body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Prepare your cards, prepare your hearts for a time. Again, if there's offering, they'll go toward encore. That can go over this plate over here. If you'd like to take home a chalice, we have more, I think. We can give more for this. This is to give to someone that needs to have the presence of the Holy Communion that's there. And so what I would do is take this one loaf that we have. Again, we have a gluten-free option for those that need to have gluten-free. And we'll have the choir come first.
Thank you.
Go forth in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Closing hymn is what, David?
Let there be peace on earth. Please sing.
Yes, no peace.